Welcome back to Made for More podcast. This episode is going to be fun, guys, because we wanted to incorporate the students that were at Youth Weekend, but perhaps some fun and interesting conversation around what they didn't see or perhaps what people are calling behind the scenes. So we're glad you're with us today. I'm going to have each of these guys introduce themselves and also what they were doing at Youth Weekend. So we'll start right here.
Yeah, guys, my name is Peyton Flowers. I was over helping facilitate our worship team, just getting team together, getting set lists, and just helping Tyler and Chad prepare worship sets and what the gatherings would look like.
And if you like the worship, just go ahead and throw a thumbs up down in the comments. Just do it all. Whatever YouTube does, do it all. Thank you, Peyton.
What up? My name is Drew Middlebrooks. I was over a lot of our front end kind of production planning, so kind of talking with Tyler and the team and kind of vision different ideas for the weekend, and then just making sure that kind of technically we are set up for success to have a easy load in and a nice, smooth, awesome weekend.
Oh yeah. Pew, 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 pew. Pew, pew. Drew Middlebrooks made it happen. So Drew was on the technical side of things, like we had the LED wall and different lighting elements and stuff in there. Wall, strip, whatever. It was awesome. Was helping implement a lot of those, load in, load out, and just kind of helping fill in the more technically skilled gaps. And I'm Brady. Hi. I meant to say that. I'm Brady. And I was there really just heading up the volunteers, the production volunteers, and helping, I guess, execute and plan the...
You can use the word producer.
The producer. I was producer for the weekend. Just the insane amount of things that we had on the docket for every schedule. It was a crazy year. It was a crazy year, but it was a lot of fun. So,
that's
yeah.
The humble way of him saying I ran the show. So aww. Brady, folks,
that's very sweet.
He turned the lights on and off. So all these guys played such a big impact to Youth Weekend, and I of course am your neighborhood genie, Chad Barfield.
Woo!
A lot of boos, a lot of claps, but I accept them all. Yep. And we obviously love doing this stuff for you guys. So, okay, y'all are familiar. You know, if you're watching this, you likely got on the bus, or if you weren't there, students got on the bus around 5 o'clock Central Time in Auburn, okay? What you guys didn't see is that this group right here was already at Camp Woodlands kind of unloading and putting the whole thing together. And then you guys had pizza here. These guys went out to eat, and I wanted them to just kind of talk about the load-in experience at Camp Woodlands and then also what they were doing as you guys were driving toward camp.
So love it.
I guess, Drew and... Yeah, actually, Drew, you just kind of lead us off, kind of what
I'll
that
start.
Was like
yeah.
on the front end.
So I think we, day of, I think we had... So we got all our, even before day of, we kind of had all our gear staged here
yep.
at the church. Not just production gear, but pretty much everything for that weekend.
Right.
Everything band related, all the signs and banners and Squad Wars knickknacks and all that kind of stuff. Had it all staged, had all that loaded up the day before, and I think left Auburn at like 6 a.m.
Don't forget the trailer hitch.
That is 6 a.m. if
you're curious. We meant to leave at 6 a.m.
Yeah, but
there you go.
People, if they don't get their coffee, it's
hey,
ugly.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
You got to get that diesel.
Yeah, so
Starbies.
Yeah, rolled out of Auburn, got there to Woodlands, which I had never been there, so I had absolutely no expectations.
First impressions with it real quick, a parentheses conversation here.
I would say it is... The way that I described it was like the perfect blank canvas
yes.
for whatever we wanted it to
agreed.
Be.
It's yeah. awesome.
You're so, welcome.
And we did not know that when we went there for the first time.
And they yeah. also did not pay us to say that.
So. This is yeah. not an advertisement for
didn't
Woodlands
pay
game.
Y'all to say that.
Oh, yeah. They
but yeah, so great team up there. But yeah, we got in, met with the Woodlands team, kind of their tech director there that we met with, kind of got some... rundown on their venue and some of the specifics of kind of the systems that we were working with. And then pretty much from there, one of my favorite parts was we kind of got gear in and really kind of had the freedom even to just kind of spread out and pray and
yeah.
kind of speak vision over the weekend and just kind of pray for the students that were going to come, pray for the space, which honestly is just a result of, I think, good planning.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Showing up equipped yeah. And kind of having the mental and logistical real estate to be able to set aside time to do that kind of thing, which I think was a game changer for our team to
oh, yeah.
like even to for the kids to walk into the space and be like, all right, like this, there's not like a spirit of chaos here.
Right.
It's like this has been like calmed, planned for, prayed over. Like the people already here are like locked in. So yep. That was great. Basically, got to do that together, got to just set up things. So everything from Aiden Miller, who's not here, did a lot of our kind of band logistics, making sure all
he is an all-star.
Yeah, the G.
All-star. Freshman in college.
He's the OG.
Better than me at everything.
If you go to the zoo, you likely see him in the goat section. Okay. Like that is his so exhibit. True.
Insert goat sound.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Hire Aiden. That was a class in high school at LaGrange.
Oh, okay. Right.
Goat class?
Goat sound. 101.
Yeah, so worked a lot of like the band logistics with that, making sure inputs and ears and everything are all squared away. Brady and Amanda did a great job of making sure all that our like visual content, so all of our song lyrics, backgrounds, all that kind of stuff was prepped, already brought in ahead of time, because we knew what most of the songs would be ahead of time.
Most of them.
And then, yeah, pretty much just throughout the day, got the room loaded in, got confetti cannons.
We'll get to that.
We'll get to that.
Cannons go
hold
boom.
Hold your horses there,
dude. Yeah, so got to load in everything, make sure everything was working. And then even break for lunch, which I don't know the name of the place we had, but the pickles.
I was hoping y'all could touch on. Someone came back from a barbecue restaurant, or I might be jumping. Was that dinner? Was barbecue?
That was dinner.
Let's go ahead.
Like a burger place.
Because they had pizza here. You guys had pizza.
Yeah.
These guys came back raving about a barbecue spot. Brady, do you mind like just touching on the experience in Cleveland, Georgia? Best barbecue in the world?
It was the only place. No, we did try going somewhere, and we had a group of, how many of us was it? 17?
18,
I guess. Yeah, 17 or 18
too
people.
Many.
It's a thick number.
So that was all the band, all the production, basically everybody who was there before. And that wasn't any of Auburn team.
Right.
I mean, they were all still here. So 17 or 18 production and band people trying to find somewhere to eat in the tiny town of Cleveland, Georgia. So we walk into this first place, and basically, I walk in, and they send me in there for whatever reason. And it was
in a bandana.
It was camp weekend. I was having fun. I was wearing a bandana, you know, how you do. And I was like, you guys really want to send me in? Anyway, so I go in there, and just immediately they were like, no. And I said, we have a party of 18, and I almost passed out on the floor. Like, I don't think they'd ever had that many people.
If they look like you, then.
Yeah, I don't know if they'd ever had that many people come together at once. So we had to drive about another 15, 20 minutes, which is maybe why we were a little behind schedule.
So they come back from dinner, and we'll jump forward to kind of session starting. And there's a lot of, I mean, we'll call it frenzy, but it's like a fun frenzy. Like a lot of excitement. Because expectation's a better word to put it. Because you just like, you plan so well, the stage looks so good, but then it's like, oh my gosh, this is actually happening. So there's a lot of elements. And Peyton, in a second here, we'll get your touch on the worship thing. But there is a big element that we just do need to talk about. Probably the most fragile experiment we've done yet. And that was five cannons just kind of jerry-rigged together to detonate at the beat drop of the opening ceremony, if you will. Now, I had the opportunity to be, out there and kind of lead that. I've been told before that these cannons, that they might break the windows. I've been told, you know, don't get anybody close because we don't know what's going to happen. But the mastermind behind all of this, guys, is sitting right here with us today. His name is Drew Middlebrooks. Okay.
Genius.
And Drew, I don't even know how to explain it. Can you just walk us through the cannon mentality behind the big boom?
Yeah, so it's
Drew
really,
Middlebrooks, the cannon mentality.
Cover the earth.
You gotta be pop centric. You gotta be focused. Yep. But yeah, so I guess that came together pretty last minute. So okay, full transparency. The reason that happened was a result of me begging Tyler to let me do it. So it was not this like larger vision. It was just Tyler's love and trust for me to allow me to be reckless and have fun. But yeah.
Reckless love.
We ordered up some of these electric confetti cannons, did a little lobby test pop.
How do you set it off? Do you have fire?
It's electric.
It's electric!
I'm nervous.
But yeah, it was super cool. Just kind of, I'd always wanted to try something like that and saw the opportunity on the horizon,
ooh,
if you will.
Wow.
Insert noise.
It's like bam, 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 bam. Yeah, so rigged them up and got them all painted up. So that's the thing is you don't know. You can't test them. It'll be like super
wasteful
and reckless to test them. So you don't really know if it's going to work or not.
Right.
And the whole time we were setting it up, we're like, I hope this doesn't just explode at any moment.
Chad, I thought, did such a good job in that moment of as they're getting closer to the beat drop, you like brought everybody down to the ground.
Correct.
To then to be aware of their safety, to then when they exploded, then they're able to jump up and scream and celebrate.
So what you thought was hype was actually safety. So
that's wow. True. So and that's leadership.
And that's ACC youth.
They did the ceiling in there was probably what, like 30 feet?
30 feet high.
30
yeah,
feet.
Yeah, sure.
And they definitely, I mean, they shot up and there was confetti up in blocking the projectors afterwards, like for the rest of the session. The fact that we had like, it was like a round, it was like the Knights of the Round Table and worship this year.
Uh-huh.
I feel like we had like 18 different people up there at one point. Peyton, I would love to hear from you on why that decision was made and how you feel like that went. Basically having like the Marvel Cinematic Universe of worship leaders up there.
Yeah, I felt like we had so many incredible people on our team that I wanted to be a part of that moment, to be a part of and get to experience, especially what happened with last year and how worship went, just how the weekend went in general. Just wanted to give people experience and just wanted to set that weekend apart and like have everybody's voice being heard,
mm-hmm.
not just their actual voice, but like what they're carrying be put into that moment. And then to have multiple worship leaders at hand, like it allows the weight of so many songs in a weekend. Cause when you're in a weekend like that, you're leading 12, 15 songs.
Yep,
so
right.
To have that weight off their shoulders to lead from a place of confidence and to be able to lead and listen to the Spirit as they're leading was something that was super important to us. So,
off the cuff, who's the best worship leader at Youth Weekend?
Wow.
And his wife was one of them. His wife was one of them.
I think I'm biased slightly towards Abby Flowers.
There we go.
Not paid to say that.
Wise man.
But he is in covenant.
There you go.
I mean, Peyton, coming from a guy who just gets to walk with these students, but also like to participate in worship, you know, like being out there, you guys did such a good job of just like ushering in the Spirit in a moment like that. And there's so much anticipation to Youth Week, like excitement. And we came out with a bang and that's World Outside Your Window, which the students love. I love.
So good.
It's a fun type of energy. But you guys do such a good job of like, no, this is who we are worshiping right here. And you guys lead very well. And I think that you invite the Spirit into that place, which was followed up very well with Tyler Miller, who I wish he could be with us today. He's probably praying for you guys right now. It's just what he does on his free time.
Or serving his wife.
So I mean, true. Same thing. No, I'm just kidding. But seriously. Okay, same thing. But, hey, you know, Tyler, you know, he brought a really good word to us the first night, and then you guys followed that up with just more worship on the back end and stuff like that. I was just kind of curious, like, from your perspective – like, what is it like to, just genuine interest from me? What's it like to follow up a message? You know what I mean? Do you feel like, you know, they always say, like, hey, let's not wait till the back set to get excited for this. But is there something, like, different about the backside? I don't know if you can touch on any point with that.
Yeah, especially, I mean, having the front set and leading them in worship, like, allowing them for them to be open to what Tyler's about to speak into.
Mm-hmm.
I think on the back end, like having heard that word, like that is then their response. Like the worship that we're singing back to the Lord in that moment is their words back to him in worship corporately. Mm-hmm. So
that's right.
It's cool to be on the backside of that, to just them being able to then respond to the word they just heard.
Yep.
Is super cool.
If we can, I would like to go and do everybody's favorite moment. You want to keep walking through?
I just wanted to get that first night because people were a part of that. But, yeah, no, I think I like that.
I just am curious to know because I think everybody...
I know I have one.
Maybe Drew and I have kind of similar perspectives. But, like, Chad, you went from, like, hosting whatever you call the thing in the beginning, the opening ceremony, and then also hosting moments, but then also you spoke on the last session, which congratulations, that was awesome. Thank you. Cool.
Thank you, Drew.
Was that your speaking debut at ACC Youth?
First time. That's the first time I've ever prepared a message and held a spiritual stage and had that opportunity.
Well, congratulations. That was well deserved. Seriously. Well deserved.
It's weird. You're right, because it's weird literally from beginning to end and it looking differently. It's like, I love having fun and stuff like that, but also have a huge heart for teaching the Bible and just like, I mean, being vulnerable. I mean, if you were there, you heard stories shared, but I mean, I just love being able to kind of hold both ends like that.
Yeah.
I want to be approachable, but I also want to know that, like, listen, we are unafraid to teach the truth here and want you guys to know more about scripture. So it was fun. That's the first time I've ever done something like that.
Yep.
For me personally, like, that was my favorite moment. Like, when it Chad's experience, that was fun.
Yep.
And then collectively as a youth weekend, like, everything was Squad Wars, specifically the slingshot station.
Yeah.
It was just so much fun.
Watching the vlog yesterday, because I didn't get to see so much of that. So I'm glad that you guys did that, just from the perspective of, like, production and band didn't necessarily get to be in every single one of those moments.
Uh-huh.
But kind of getting to see the inner workings of the... what obviously was super intense in the Squad Wars and stuff.
It was
so
fun.
That's so much fun.
So the message on Sunday was just a dream. It was an answered prayer for me, but then having fun with the slingshot and throwing some eggs up in the sky, hitting it on our heads. It sounds ridiculous, but it was a lot of fun. So
it
that
was
my
ridiculous.
Favorite part, too. Get both best of both worlds.
Yep. And then Peyton obviously being, you know, on stage probably, I mean, definitely, you know, on the stage with the most.
Time.
Yeah, you were on stage every single time.
Yeah.
You were the one MDing, which, for those of you who don't know, is music directing, I guess, in the past tense.
Yeah.
Music director, MD. Mm-hmm. So he's, not only is he, you know, playing electric guitar, providing atmosphere, you know, as a musician and worship leader in that moment, but also you are directing the team actively throughout the song, you know, whether it's a change of pace or get back on track or, you know, going from one song to the next. So I know you're carrying a heavy load just logistically in your mind over the weekend, but also, you know, you got to look out at what was happening.
Yeah.
I kind of envy that spot.
Yeah, yeah.
You got to look out at what was happening the most out of anybody.
Yeah.
So that's why I'm curious to know what it was like from your end and what your favorite moment was.
Yeah. It is an absolute honor just to be on the stage leading the students. I think specifically Saturday night with Gage coming in, bringing an incredible word to the students, and then just being on the back end of that and just seeing, like, as you're on stage and you're leading them, like, you can see, like, their reaction, like you can see the Lord doing things in the students as they're worshiping.
Wow.
Like they're fighting through things, they are praising Him in the moment that they're in, and just to be able to physically see that as you're worshiping, as you're leading them in worship, is so cool. Like, it is why we do this, because we're not here to perform a song. We're not here to play music. The sole purpose is to make sure the students are in more awe and wonder of who God is every time we lead. And so just to see that happening in real time as they're singing and lifting up praises is so cool.
That's awesome.
Wow.
Gracious Tempest on that back end
was like
out of this world, heavenly.
Yep.
You could call it.
Mm. One might call it.
One might call
throne room mentality.
But that was beautiful, and that's an awesome perspective to have, Peyton. I appreciate you sharing that.
What was the riskiest song you feel like for the weekend that you were like, whether you'd never done it, or, you know, also whether you guys didn't know if you were gonna nail it or not, but more just from a perspective of, like, not sure how this is gonna land, risky. What do you feel like? What's your biggest surprise as far as how a song went?
I think in all, I was extremely excited about going into the weekend. I thought the team was really prepared. We ended up rehearsing here at the church a couple of times just to make sure everything was, every I was dotted and everything was crossed.
Yep.
And so I think from a preparation standpoint, we felt good.
Yep.
I don't know. I think we did a couple of new songs. We did Awake My Soul, the Hillsong United.
That was so good.
Hillsong Worship. Yep. So good to have Jordan Harmon be able to lead that. Just a song that we'd never really done before. And so just the seeing how the students reacted to it doing it, those morning sessions, and I thought they latched onto it really quick. So
yep.
That was the one song we were hesitant about, but then it landed really well.
Yeah,
we were super excited about it.
So a lot of talk from our end, but curious for you guys, what was y'all's favorite part? Drew, this was your first ACC retreat, like period?
Yep,
or?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
It was. So, I've done stuff here at ACC, like wake stuff. But, yeah, that was my first off-site retreat kind of thing. I would say probably two-part answer. So that being my first time, I would say like globally, the biggest thing that hit me was just being reminded of being that age. And that was really when I was that kind of a high school age is when I,
yep.
Found the Lord and really just kind of started that spiritual journey. And like the formative things that the Lord spoke to me in events literally exactly like that at D-Nows and youth weekends and things like that. And
that's where it starts.
It was so incredible just to be reminded of the things the Lord had done in my heart at that age and at that time, and to just look out and think like, wow, I can't even imagine the things that he is doing right now in these same hearts of these kids that are here, and what, you know, everything that he's gonna carry out in their lives. So that was kind of like my big picture takeaway, is just the reminder of like how formative those moments are. But I would say, like, specifically, I think it was Saturday night after message. Was that the Gracious Tempest?
Yes,
that was
right.
Jess Keys and vocals.
Yep.
To me, it was incredible. Like, I think you have the really high highs, the big intros and all that, but you can't have the highs without the lows, or not even you can't have the hype without the intimacy.
Right. Yeah.
They have to complement each other, and you can't, comparatively, you can't have one without the other. And so just that super broken down kind of reflective moment.
I almost feel like hype is almost easier in a way to pull off sometimes. Yeah. Easier to, it's almost like you have more room for error in a hype moment, you know?
Right. Yeah. The hype really just gives you the comparative opportunity to make something more intimate.
Yep.
So to have that moment, and just that, I don't never really heard who like kind of crafted or came up with that, but I had nothing to do with it. So to just to be able to show up and kind of be surprised by that moment, I didn't know what I was going to be, what to expect. Was incredible. Just
because that was after Gage, right?
Correct.
Saturday. So was that Gage, or was that
Gage
more,
Saturday night?
Did he say? Was it more Gage came and said we're doing Gracious Tempest, or was that you, Peyton?
It was.
How did
really,
that go down?
It was really a song that Tyler and the youth team that they had really felt like the Lord was telling them to do the song in some sort of context, and trying to figure out where to fit that in the weekend, and then just really. It honestly lined up perfectly where with Gage was landing in the message. It kind of all just came together. Really, really Tyler and the team bringing the song to my attention, and then going from there. It just all lined up perfectly.
My first time hearing that song at rehearsal.
Wow.
I've never heard that
song. It's not that new. It's not really new at all.
Yeah, it's an older song.
And I had never heard it either.
Really?
It was mid-January, and I was like, oh, my gosh. And you're right. Like, the whole team in there was like, whoa, this is a beautiful song.
Yeah, and the call to the response time, like you said so many times, I feel like you can almost scoot over that in a way, or you can present it in a way that I feel like in that moment I didn't feel like anything was forced, but it was like it left room for the Holy Spirit.
Oh yes.
All we're gonna do is provide an atmosphere, you know. It's not, we're not gonna try and like, I don't know, you know, guilt you with intensity or make you burst into tears or something, you know. It's like it really felt like an unforced rhythm of Holy Spirit opportunity in that moment. And that's what I think was such a win for that moment.
Completely agree.
Yeah. And for me, my like, I will probably never forget this moment from the weekend. Well, I mean, there were a few. We haven't talked about Matt doing the worm yet. But we can touch on that later. Yeah. We can touch on that later.
Tiny hands.
Yeah, yeah. We haven't talked about any of the antics or anything.
I have tiny hands. I do.
But so as far as like what I'm going to walk away, the moment where it felt the thinnest, I know we use that a lot, where heaven meets earth.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And it was the it was Saturday night, which was the last session I was able to be there for. I had to come back for church on Sunday, so we left after that session on Saturday. But Saturday night, I actually relieved our ProPresenter operator, which is just the slides on the screen. Amanda, she is an LDP here with us.
And absolutely killed
Absolutely killed the whole weekend. Just rocked all the lyrics, everything. Just so talented. Just a gift of God. But so she had been absolutely carrying that burden, and just the Lord doing things in her totally unrelated to what was happening, you know, with the youth and in that moment. And I just felt, really, it was my wife, shout out Reed. My wife was like, you need to go get Amanda off of Pro and let her worship this last set. And I was like, you got it. That's direct, good. Direct line. So I went up there and was like, it's funny because I walked up to her when Gage was kind of getting done. And I said, I just walked up and was like, hey, you know, you just go worship. And she like was already like halfway to handing me the keyboard. Like it was one of those moments where like she knew, I think, or she was that eager to be done. So one or the other. But while I was up there, basically just hitting spacebar, moving forward the lyrics and things, I had this moment, and this is kind of what Drew touched on this a little bit, but this is kind of what I felt led to share on the front end of the weekend when we were spending that time praying and leaning into what the weekend was going to be and what the Lord had for it was. Just I felt this call to go back in our minds as people who have been, I mean, I can almost say without a doubt, everybody at this table was touched by some sort of youth ministry. But so that being the time where you came alive and going, don't discount, you know, 2 Timothy 4:12, is that
right.
what it is?
That's right.
Don't let anyone look down on you because you're young. Mm-hmm. And you hear that and go, I don't. But then you also go, hey, you remember when you were 12, when you were 13? These are not just kids coming to an event because they have to and watching something being performed. These are souls encountering the living, breathing God. And I told them in the front end, that's when I remember I was at a student life camp and I was 12 years old. And like, I say the Holy Spirit got a hold of me because what I mean is like, I would read the Bible and it would like make sense. Like things would click for me. And so I had this moment where I was up at the top and the booth is kind of tiered up a little bit to where you're kind of higher than everybody else in the room. So I could look out. And I had this moment where we were worshiping at the end and I saw everything and it was like the Lord gave me this like, almost like in a moment, I was like transported to where I was one of those kids.
Wow.
And I just started crying and I'm like trying to like run ProPresenter, but like I'm just crying because it was like me, exactly. You know, it was me, I was thinking, imagining my life, what I've experienced over the past 12 years. I've been doing events like this, doing live events since I knew Jesus. I started helping out with production and running ProPresenter. Running slides was the first thing I ever did. When after that Shaco Springs camp, I came back and started running slides in the fall. And I've been serving there ever since. I've been serving in the church ever since. And so in that moment, it was like, the Lord was like, do you see what I can do with your life and the moments that you're now able to help make happen? Like, imagine what this room of 150 kids can do for the world. And I'm giving, by my grace, I'm giving you this opportunity, Brady, to be a part of this. And I was, man, I mean, that was one of those moments where the Lord just grabs you and you don't forget, you know. It's like he whispers it so gently but so clearly. So that was my, like, oh, my gosh, I'm starstruck moment from the weekend.
And there's no doubt about it that we were just kind of standing in the prayers of the church behind us and the prayers of generations, I guess, above us who were like, I mean, you know, we're going through Children of Revival right now, but to play our part in that at this weekend, I feel like a lot of students, myself included to a degree, is just stepping into that identity that we are called as children of God. So it was incredible. And you guys, thank you for taking a little time and talking with us. I know we're kind of wrapping up the end of the end of the session here. It's just fun talking with the brains behind the whole project here. And we are gifted with some of the best. So please do your part and just give these guys some thanks in the comment section or something like that. I'm so horrible at just like saying what to do with things like this.
Like and subscribe.
Like and subscribe.
Like
do
and
it all.
Subscribe.
Cartwheels, backflips, corn dogs. We got it all here.
We got it all.
This has been Made for More. Thank you guys for tuning in. We'll see you next time.
Bye, guys.